Good morning. Our Sunday school lesson today for the international lesson is taken from the 10th chapter of Luke. It's a story that we're probably familiar with, even though we may not remember all of it as it is in the Bible, but it's the story of what's called the Good Samaritan. As I say, it's in Luke chapter 10. When we look at that, just to kind of review the story a little bit, a young scribe comes to Jesus and says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says to him, what are the commandments? And he speaks the commandments and tells him, and Jesus says, you do this and you'll live. And then he asks him about what's the greatest commandment. And the young man responds by saying, well, it's to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your might, and with it to love your neighbors yourself. Now, those two same commandments are found in Matthew and in Luke in a little bit different situation. It's still the great commandment that has to do with our relationship with God, and the second commandment that has to do with our relationship with one another. In this situation, when the young man responds and says that you love God and you love your neighbor, and Jesus says, you do that and you'll live. Then the young man says, but who's my neighbor? And that's where the story goes a little differently than it does in Matthew and Mark. That's when Jesus tells this story. Now, there are six people involved in the story. Five of them are Jewish. There's the man who's going along the road and he gets robbed. There's the people that rob him, the bandits. There's the priest that comes along and sees him and says, oh, I best not get involved in this. After all, if he's dead, I'll be unclean and I won't be able to officiate at the temple. Then there's a Levite. And Levites were the kind of the assistants in the temple. We sometimes think of them as the custodians, and that was part of their job, but they were more than that. They provided for the appropriateness of the sacrifice and did some other things that had to do with the cleansing of the temple and keeping it that way. And he also didn't stop and help the person. So there we've got three of the five, four of them, the man, the bandits, priest, the Levite. Now along comes this Samaritan. And we're going to talk about what Samaritans were, or who they were, in just a moment. But he comes along and he stops. And he goes over and looks and checks at the man and decides that he can help. He bandages him up, anoints him with wine and oil, because those two were basically considered cleansing and healing agents for a person. And puts him on his own beast, his own donkey, and takes him ahead. Comes to the inn. The innkeeper would be pretty much obviously Jewish. Now here's the thing. The Samaritan man brings this man to him. He may not be allowed to even enter the inn, but he brings him there, knocks on the door. The innkeeper comes. He says, look, I found this man along the roadside. Here is the money to take care of him. Now, the Samaritan's money is just as good as anybody else's money when it comes to money. So he gives him the money and he says, if it costs more to take care of him on my way back, I will pay the difference. Now that's opening up for a lot of deceit, because the innkeeper could exaggerate the bills. He could kind of plush the account for the man. But in the story, he goes on his way and leaves the man there, and we assume that he's taken care of, and the Samaritan comes back. Now, there's five characters there that are Jewish, and one that's a Samaritan. You may have heard of Samaritans. There's a hospital in Lebanon called the Good Samaritan Hospital. If you travel a lot, you can join a club called the Good Sam Club. All of those are names that we've given from the time of Jesus telling his story. But at the time Jesus told the story, the word good and the word Samaritan did not fit together. as far as the Jewish people were concerned. You know, we call those oxymorons. It's two words. It's like plastic silverware. Doesn't happen. It's plastic. It's not silver. Good. It's not a Samaritan. Samaritan, it's not good. It's kind of like Philip Sheridan, General Philip Sheridan, who said the only good Indian's a dead one. You couldn't find a good Indian. So, anyway, how did we get Samaritans? Because you see, Jesus in John chapter 4 stops at a well in Samaria and talks to a Samaritan woman. And that becomes one of his first evangelistic experiences with people, and it's with a Samaritan woman. And you can read about that in John chapter 4. Anyway, we have to go back 1,000 years before the time of Jesus. 1,000 years. Now, imagine coming 1,000 years after the time of Jesus to the year 1,000. And I'll talk about what was happening in the year 1,000. But we're going back to the year 1,000 before Jesus. That's when we had the beginning of the monarchy. That's when we had the first kings. The last of the judges was Samuel. The first of the kings was Saul, then David, then Solomon. Only three kings were in that united monarchy of Israel. When Solomon's son came on the throne, came to be anointed king, the people asked him to slack off on the burdens. You see, Solomon had enslaved the people, which was against the law, but he'd done it, and you had to work 12 months free on his building projects, which included his palace as well as the temple that he was building. You had to provide, each tribe had to provide food for 1 month on his tables. It was an expensive deal because he had many wives, he had many servants, and to feed all of those was an exorbitant cost on the people. And so they went to Rehoboam, his son, and they said, please consider us, have understanding and compassion for us for the burdens that your father laid upon us. And Rehoboam responded by saying, if my father whipped you with ropes, I'm going to whip you with scorpions. He had no compassion whatsoever. Well, there was a man named Jeroboam who had worked for his father. He had been in charge of the slave labor. He saw how much it hurt the people, and he had fled from Solomon into Egypt, and he was down there. He came back after Solomon died and was with the people on the north. Now, Rehoboam had come up to Shechem. That's in Samaria, come up there to be crowned king. Joshua had brought the Ten Commandments and the Ark up to Shechem after they had had the battle of Jericho and Ai, and they went up there, and on one mountain, Mount Ebal, and on another mountain, Mount Gerizim, he spoke to the people and gave them the commands of God. So Shechem and Samaria were important places already, and Rehoboam was coming there to be crowned king of the whole place. But when he told the people he was going to whip them with scorpions, there was a rebellion. And Jeroboam said, to your tents, Israel, we have no part in Judah. And so they left and they began to form an army. Well, Rehoboam took off, headed back down to Jerusalem, where he had the support of the tribe of Judah. That was about all he had, was Judah's support. And the rest were against him. Now, you have a kingdom in the north, it's called Israel. You have a kingdom in the south, it's called Judah. You have Egypt off to the south and the west, a powerful nation. And to the north, you have Assyria. Now, Assyria and Egypt didn't like each other. And sometimes they would battle each other, even on the land of Israel. And there would be hard times. Sometimes Israel would want to be an ally of Egypt. That's where Jeroboam had found exile during the time he fled from Solomon. So they'd had some good workings there with that. But at one point, Assyria got fed up with all of it. And it wasn't in Jeroboam's time. They had many kings. Some kings only lasted for 6 months. They went down through kings. But for about 200 years, they were there. Almost, well, not quite 200 years. They were there. About 700 years before the time of Jesus, Assyria came down and conquered the kingdom of Israel and took a lot of the people off into captivity up into Assyria, and we never hear of them again. Now, the Mormon church says those 10 lost tribes became the Native Americans in this country, the North American Indians. They crossed over the Bering Strait and came down from Alaska and migrated into this. There's a group called Anglo-Israel. They believe that the English became that, and they base it on Isaac's sons. We get our word Saxon from that. It's not good thinking, but that's what they hold to. They're called Anglo-Israelites. In any event, they're not heard of. But the other thing that Assyria did was they brought other captive people down into the land of Israel and replaced the people they took out with these people. Now, they did that for a purpose, because when you displace people, it's hard for them to work together. We have people with different languages here now trying to get along with each other. It's almost like the Tower of Babel again. But in any event, there were some good-looking girls that were brought down by the Assyrians. There were some good-looking boys that were left there, and vice versa, some good-looking boys that were brought down, some good-looking girls, and they began to intermarry, and they had children. Now, they weren't true Israelites. They weren't true people from the other country. They kind of picked up the name Samaritans because they lived in the land Samaria. And they had their own temple there. It had been destroyed a couple of times by Judah and by the Assyrians, but still they had a plan of worship there. Now, that's about the year 722 that happens. For another couple of hundred years, not even 100 years, not 200 years, about 150 years, the land below them called the Kingdom of Judah, which had descendants of David on their throne, continues on, and they also kind of see Egypt as a safety valve. And now what happened up north was Babylon conquered Assyria. And Babylon now is the ruler, and they came down, and about two or three times they came down and conquered Judah, and Judah would kind of, you know, bow the knee and stuff like that to Babylon, but they kept rebelling. And finally Babylon came down, Sennacherib and other of his armies, and they just totally destroyed, burned down the temple, tore down the walls of Jerusalem, and hauled the people off into captivity. Now there's where you read about Daniel, you read about Esther, part of Ezekiel has to do with that, as well as some of the other prophets that spoke and warned Judah about the coming of the Babylonians, the power of the north. Now, the Babylonians are conquered by the Persians, and they come on the throne, Darius, and they say, look, you folks can go back to your land. And so there is the great return, and that's in the story of Nehemiah and Ezra, that we hear about the return of the people. And they come back and their land has been devastated, but they've stayed true Jews in the land of Babylon. They have had their own little community and they've kept to that, and they've kept their ethnic purity, you might say. So they come back down and they start to rebuild, while the Samaritans say, hey, we'd like to help you. And the Jews say, no, we don't want a bunch of half-breeds working with us. Now that seems kind of cruel, and it probably is. I know when I lived among the Indians out in Oklahoma, sometimes people would make snide remarks about different Indians, and sometimes one tribe would say it to another. They call people half-breeds. You could say it in a positive way. That's the negative way. You could say, well, you have a multi-ethnic background, don't you? You know, which kind of sounds like, hey, I'm special. But half-breed does not make you sound special. So this division was enhanced and intensified between the Samaritans and the Jews who were from Judah. Now, the Samaritans had the scriptures. The five books of Moses, the Pentateuch, was their Bible, just as it was the Bible of the Jews. But the Jews had begun to add other books to their Bible. They had added some of the prophets, like Isaiah, Jeremiah, Daniel, Ezekiel. They had a book they called the 12. We have all as different books in the Bible, but they called them the 12. And that included Joel and Amos and other Habakkuk and many other of the prophets. Now, they wouldn't go together, so they wouldn't work together with each other at that point. Now comes this situation where, as time progresses, we come down to the time of Jesus. And a good Jew would not go from Galilee straight down through Samaria to Judah. They would go across the river, down Perea, and cross back over to get to Jerusalem. Jesus, on more than one occasion, went straight through Samaria. One time, he was going through Samaria, and you read about it in Luke, and he was going to Jerusalem because he was going to die. And the people of Samaria, when they learned that Jesus was going to Jerusalem, were mad. And they called him names and, just were terrible. And the disciples said, "Do you want us to call down fire from heaven on them and burn them?" And Jesus said, "I didn't come to destroy. I came to give life. Let's go." And so they left. But here he was. He had told a story about a good Samaritan. He had done that. As a matter of fact, he had even been called a Samaritan in Luke chapter 8. The Jewish leader said, "You're nothing more than a Samaritan." It's kind of using the N-word. That was about as big a put-down as you could get. And Jesus did not resent it. Even on the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them." The whole point of it is that this young man had said to Jesus, "Who's my neighbor?" And Jesus said, "What are you? And who are you a neighbor to?" In other words, who are you willing to have? The Samaritan proved to be the neighbor. He was the one who helped his neighbor. And we are that way. And sometimes there may be people that we can help that we really wouldn't like to have as friends necessarily. But they need our help, and we help them. Or there may be situations where there are people who look at us and say, "You're nothing but a half-breed. You're a nothing." And we kind of feel angry, and we feel hurt. And it's hard to be forgiving, but it's both. Mr. Rogers had a program called Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And in that, he proved himself to be a neighbor to a lot of people, and he helped others to be neighbors to them as well. So, in this coming week, as we think about the story of the Good Samaritan, it's an opportunity for us to say, who is my neighbor? Not necessarily the person I like, but the person to whom I can offer my help. And who am I a neighbor to? That is, the person who doesn't like me. How can I be a neighbor to them? And how can I let them be a neighbor to me? I close with this one story. I had a person in my church in Oklahoma. Her name was Tichaway, Margaret Tichaway. She was a Kiowa Indian. Her husband was Comanche. Margaret was a wonderful Christian woman. She was doing so much for everybody. Margaret got sick, and some people called and said, "We'd like to bring food for you and for Cecil." Cecil was her husband. And she said, "Oh, no, no, we're fine, we're fine." And I remember going to Margaret and saying, "Margaret, you're not letting these people be a Christian to you. They want to reach out and help you, but you're rejecting them. They want to be loving to you, and you've rejected them. And I understand why you do it. But Christ asks us to also let others be a Christian to us." So there may be somebody that you can allow this week to be a Christian to you. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us this day. Ask your blessing upon us, and ask us to be a blessing upon others. All this in Jesus' name. Amen.